Hi, welcome. I'm Tina Jobes, representing the National Retail Federation, and welcome to this afternoon's store tour presentation. Tour of innovative stores delivering with purpose. This tour is led by our friends at Accenture Customer Innovation Network. Before we begin, I'd like to direct your attention to this session in the mobile app for session and speaker details and for rating the session. And by the way, each rating increases NRF support to Charity Water, the beneficiary of our donations this year. We have store tour brochures for you. If you missed getting one on your way in, raise your hand. We've got some people with brochures that can bring you one, or you can pick one up on the way out, whatever's most convenient. And thanks to Accenture, we have a mobile version of the NRF app in the NRF app that will help you locate your stores in the city digitally. Two amazing retail experts, Director of Strategic Partnerships for Council of Fashion Designers of America, Ashley Sandall, and M.M. LaFleur's Director of Offline Retail, Rachel Mann, are here to tell you why their flagships are must-sees for your tour. And I'd also like to introduce your guide for this onstage tour. As global lead of Accenture's Customer Innovation Network, she and her team have done an amazing job spending hours of many hours of time, actually, of their time compiling this journey for you. So please join me in welcoming Karen Volker.
Thanks, Tina. Hi, everyone. I am joined by two fabulous ladies that are in our fashion fashion industry. Ashley Sandall, here from the CFDA, or Council of Fashion Designers of America. One interesting fact about her that I just recently learned is she's an avid tennis player. So any of you guys want to take her up in a tennis match? And then Rachel Mann from M.M. LaFleur, which I have a mild shopping obsession with their company right now. You may recognize her. She was a child actress, and she was in a Life cereal commercial. So see if you guys can find it later on YouTube. And I guess I should share an interesting fact about myself. I grew up always in the Midwest. I live in the suburbs of Chicago right now. And I grew up on farms and with horses. And I actually hated them because my parents would always leave and make us take care of them. And you get ready for school, and then you would have hay all over you. But always a Midwest girl, so that's some interesting fact about myself. I love to shop. I'm very fortunate to have my job with Accenture to talk about what's the future of retail. And today I'm going to share a little bit about what does purpose mean to a retailer. And then Ashley and Rachel are going to share what they're doing in their stores and how they're expressing what their purpose is. And then at the end, make sure you stay, because I am going to share some not-missed stores in New York, ones that I think you should go out and visit. So hopefully you stick around for the entire time. Oops, make sure this works. Can we get it to go to the next slide, please? All right. So technology is advancing so fast, and that's not a surprise for any of you, but more importantly, consumers are adapting to this technology faster than I think any of us have ever expected. And when you look at what consumers value, they really value time. But I think this means multiple different things. They want that deep expertise. They crave that, especially in stores. If they're coming to your store, they want to talk to an expert. They want some advice, understand what's right for them. They want to be present. They want those digital detox moments. How can they be present in their lives? And these micro moments matter. And I'm going to talk a lot about moments and what that means to purpose. But they're spending more on experiences, not just your products, because products are becoming a commodity. So how are they going to get your consumers to think about your brand and what it means to them? So what we like to say is consumers have very liquid expectations. And what we mean by that is retailers are getting their expectations set by actually companies outside the retail industry. One of my favorite examples of this is if you watch any child. And one of my favorite things was Zipcar. I was out with my kids one day, and we wanted to go somewhere on a quick tour, and so we grabbed a zip car, pulled the app out, and then probably about a week later, we're walking down the street, and they see this hot little red sports car, and my young son, Dane, goes, "Mom, get your app out. We're going to take that for a drive." And they just expect it to happen, because they see it happen in one place. They expect it to happen everywhere else. Uber is a fantastic example of that also. Uber has set the expectation of transparency and, more importantly, ease of payment. And I think that's what a lot of retailers are trying to struggle with, to figure out how they can keep up with some of these other companies outside the retail industry. If you look at what community, Lululemon stands great for building a community, but also if you look at Waze, Waze is great at a community all coming together to not only save you time, but also make sure you don't get those tickets from the police. It always helps me. And then you look at convenience. Not here, just in New York City, there's a company starting up called Capsule that wants to completely change what we think about pharmacy today. They're able to load all your prescriptions up and get them delivered to you within an hour or two. So there's a lot of things that are happening outside of retail that are setting consumers' expectations. And when you look at how brands are in consumers' lives, they're very much in certain channels today. But what you need to start thinking about is all of the touch points, all of the places that you can interact with your consumer. It's not just your physical store and your website. So how do you get your consumer to think about you in these micro moments? When the consumer's in their bathroom and they realize they're out of toothpaste, they're out of mascara, when they're getting dressed in their closet in the morning, how do you get the consumer to think about you in multiple different ways? So in the past, retail was really about buying economic, in buying in quantity, and being efficient in when they're selling it. But today, we truly believe it is about a consumer buying from someone that they, something that they desire, from someone that they trust, in that moment. And I think the trust and the moment are what's most important. So how are you going to get the customer to think about you in those moments? So we look at, you know, what really is purpose? Do you guys have a purpose at your retailer? Do you know what it is? What do you stand for? It's not, I'm telling you, it's not just selling a product. If your purpose is to sell a product, that's not a purpose. So we looked at some definitions. We wanted to understand what we saw out there. So we saw a purpose is really about a reason for being in a business. It's really about what do you stand for? What's your historical, ethical, emotional terms? And then if you do your purpose well, it will build that trust over time. So we wanted to deep dive into this further to prove the point. So we have done looked at three different surveys. We have internally within Accenture done a survey called the Love Index. And this is really looking at those micro moments and understanding, do customers find you helpful? Do they find you authentic? Are you fun? Are you relevant? Then we looked at Gallup actually has a study out on purpose. So we wanted to see if we could prove what Gallup was also saying. And then we went out and interviewed consumers. Let's look at different brands. Do you know what Trader Joe's stands for? What do you think their purpose is? Are they manifesting it in their stores? So we did find out, no surprise, that purpose does matter. And we are going to start to release the results of this survey over the next month. But what we, some of the big highlights is that we found that purpose is really built on trust. And I think trust is a very individual metric and what trust means to you. It could be security, but it could be, are you relevant for me? Are you in that moment? Do you have really good customer service? And being fun doesn't mean that you're going to be trustworthy. So how are you going to be relevant? How are you showing up in your consumers' lives? So the two brands that I invited here today, I believe, have a very strong purpose messaging in their physical spaces. So that's why I'm going to invite Ashley up to talk about what they're doing with the Council of Fashion Designers of America.
Hi. Thanks, Karen. So I'm Ashley Sandel, and I'm the Director of Strategic Partnerships at the
CFDA. And for those of you who don't know what the CFDA is, we're actually a nonprofit trade organization that is comprised of over 500 of America's most prolific fashion designers. And our mission is really to support the individual designer, the brand, and really give them a space both in the United States and globally that helps support their business. So it's a great job. It's an incredible organization. Diane von Furstenberg is our president, and whenever you're at a board meeting, you learn amazing words of wisdom from her, and you also hear a lot of fun stories about Studio 54 in the 70s. So it's not a bad job to have. But the way that we came about this partnership, so what I do in my role is I work with a lot of corporate partners, like Cadillac, obviously, Google, Lexus, Starbucks, and I really help those companies connect with brands and also help, from a marketing standpoint, tell their brand identity story through the language of fashion. So Cadillac was a partner that we had because they were one of the founding partners of New York Fashion Week Men's, which is coming up again. And in speaking with their team, they were talking about how they were moving their headquarters from Detroit. They wanted to kind of be a standalone brand and separate a little bit from GM. And they were building this incredible brand experiential center called Cadillac House. And in Cadillac House, you can come and experience art, culture, food. They have a lot of events, and they wanted us to basically help them with the narrative of fashion. And in thinking about what Cadillac's purpose is yes, there are cars there, but it's not meant to be in, you know, a dealership. It's not meant to be a showroom. I came up with the program Retail Lab because we have about 850 square feet in Cadillac House that is a blank canvas. And in thinking about the program, designers can, you know, get a square, throw some paint on the wall, buy some cheap furniture, and have a pop-up store. And yes, it's a great revenue stream, but it really doesn't prepare them for what it's like to have your own brick-and-mortar store. So what we wanted to do is come up with a program, Retail Lab, and it's an application-based program. We have four designers go through it each year. And it not only has the physical space, but it has an advisory board. So we are lucky enough to have people like Stephen Allen and Stacey Bendit from Alice and Olivia, who have amazing retailers and they're amazing brands. And then we work with, you know, industry notables like Robin Kramer, who's an incredible interior designer just for stores. So one of the first brands, and I'm just going to walk you through just some case studies. One of the first brands that we had is Cushney and Ox, and they're a luxury ready-to-wear brand. They're a women's brand. And although they have great business online, and they're sold at Barney's, they're sold at Saks, they don't have a physical space. So in helping them come up with this concept, they really wanted product to be second. And as you can see, I mean, we do have some products on the floor, but it was really meant to, like, if you were to walk into the designer's, you know, boudoir, what would it be like? And I think, as Karen mentioned, it's connecting with customers in an authentic way to really tell your brand story so that, as a customer, you don't feel like, okay, they just want me to buy something. But it's like, I can come in, I can sit down, I can smell the flowers, and you know, it's a great place for them to kind of try out their brand identity. And one of the other brands that we had come through the program was Public School. Now, Public School is very different. They're kind of a streetwear brand. They're sold at, you know, Kith. They're very cool. They have a cult following. And what they wanted to do was kind of create that Instagrammable moment. So I was the one who got to send the email to Cadillac's head of marketing and say, hey, what would you think if we took a car, cut it in half, and made it look like it was crashing through a wall? And surprisingly, they said yes. So I think if anyone is familiar with public school as a brand, you can see this is very reminiscent, it's very edgy. And their retail strategy was to every 2 weeks do exclusive collaborations and drops, if you will. So they worked with Nike, they did something with New Era, they had Fitbit, and it really creates a sense of urgency for their customer, and they also have a diehard customer. So when the Nike Air Jordans came out, the public school edition, I think we had 300 people waiting in line outside Cadillac House. And that's something you see at Kith, but it's not something that you would see at a, you know, a brand experiential center like Cadillac. So another great case study is, let's see here, Tanya Taylor, who is an advanced contemporary women's wear brand. And we slotted her residency in the spring. Obviously, when we go through the application program process, we ask designers, what's your best-selling season? What are you kind of known for? And Tanya is really known for her feminine, whimsical prints. But now that we had had a year into the program, we realized that one of the things we wanted to do was just get a little bit more integration throughout the house. So we worked with Tanya to come up with a brand video, and Cadillac House, for those of you who haven't been there, they have these amazing screens, and we really wanted to utilize the screens so that, you know, people walking by could say, hey, what's going on there? Like, what are those pretty flowers? You know, and just be curious. And one of the things Tanya also did, which I thought was great, is we did a partnership with Lyft. And so we took an Escalade and basically covered it in one of her prints. And we used the Lyft for the first two weeks that her store was open to essentially pick up editors, pick up VIP customers. We had a little bit of an on-demand service. So if you bought a dress and you needed it delivered, you know, to your office or something, we could use the car. And we did something kind of fun, too, because one of the things that I think a lot of customers are very savvy to is they want to connect with the brand. It's great to love the product, but what is the brand story? What is Tanya's identity? What makes her different than any other floral dress that's you know, on the rack? And so we picked a couple days in Tanya's schedule where she was like the surprise passenger in the Lyft car, which was great because a lot of people who are fans of the brand, it's such an incredible experience to meet the designer. And then lastly, we worked with another women's luxury designer, Prabal Gurung. And Prabal has been getting a lot of press recently for his t-shirts that really kind of speak about some of the women's issues and political movement that is happening now. And we wanted to also kind of amp up some of the technology because Retail Lab, the name is lab for a specific purpose. We wanted to really kind of test out new technology. It's a great place to fail, right? It's not the same as if you have your own store and you implement a technology and then it fails. So we actually worked with Fjord, who is our innovation partner, on these custom fixtures because Prabal's story is very unique. He's from Nepal. He's probably the only fashion designer, at least that I've ever heard of, from Nepal. And so he uses a lot of textiles and fibers from his home country, and that was a great way for customers to kind of learn a little bit more about you know, what they're buying. And then we had this mannequin that actually took some of the slogans from the t-shirts, and it was on rotation. So that's just kind of a new display technique. And maybe you will see them someday soon in your next retail store. So we combine technology with the traditional mannequin. I mean, obviously, you know, customers are used to a certain experience, but we want to kind of change it up a little bit. And then one of the last partnerships that I launched is with Fred Siegel. So Fred Siegel just moved from their iconic location in Melrose to a new shop in Sunset. And we have about 200 square feet, so we can't do the same level of customization, and it's also multi-brand. But what we do try to do is come up with an opportunity for designers, some of whom are very established, like Nanette Lepore, with emerging designers like Wit, who have this great opportunity to sell at an iconic retailer, but do it through the CFDA's voice. And it's pretty turnkey, but I think it's a great way for brands to kind of experiment, learn a little bit about their customer base on the West Coast. And again, this changes every quarter, so we bring new brands in, and it allows, you know, the Fred Siegel customer to get excited and have a reason to come back. So that's just a few of my case studies, and I'll hand it over to Rachel.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. My name is Rachel Mann. I'm director of offline retail for MM LaFleur. And thank you so much to Karen and everyone for having us here today. So before I dive in, I just wanted to give you a little bit of background on MM LaFleur. Our mission is to take the work out of dressing for work. And we do that by providing a wardrobe solution for the professional woman. And today, Karen was talking about purpose. If we really take a step back and we look at MM LaFleur's larger purpose, the why of the business, why do we exist? We believe that when women succeed in the workplace, the world becomes a better place. Now, that is a very large why. Yes, exactly. Cheers. You guys get it. So, you know, we can't do that all by ourselves, but how can a fashion brand contribute to something like that? Our role is really to harness the power of self-presentation. That is something that we can do, and we do it really with three pillars of our business. And the first pillar is to provide a seamless, stylist-facilitated shopping experience, which I will get a little bit more into. The second is to connect our customer with a community of like-minded women. And the third is to offer compelling content. So, how does this translate into the store? Well, I would say we really do take those three pillars and very much integrate it into our entire experience. And our experience is very unique and unlike a lot of stores that you might visit while you're here in New York. But I did want to spend a little bit of time on the stylist and why do we have a stylist and why is that so important to our business? I think something Karen also talked about was trust. And we really do want women to trust the brand and trust that when they walk out and they find pieces they are really well-fitting, that they look professional and that they're going to be comfortable and get the most value. And not only that they're walking out with the right pieces, but that when they do and when they go to get dressed in the morning and they have 500 other things to think about and other decisions to make, they can throw it on and they've kind of learned how to style the pieces together. So we've invested a lot in training an incredible stylist team, both online and offline. And this team are really experts. They know the clothing, they know the fabric, they know how to care for the fabric, and they know all about, they do a lot of research about what different workplaces need in terms of dress codes, or like a presentation today, or, you know, and the different formalities. What does business formal mean? What does business professional mean? And such. So when people come to our store, it's really all about the stylist experience and providing a productive, personalized, and stress-free shopping experience. So I think the anti-MM LaFleur, and I don't know if any of you have been there, but is going to like a large department store, and you're walking around, and you know that you have a business trip coming up next week or a special event, but you don't know exactly what you want, and you're walking around, and you can't find your size, and you can't find anyone to help you, and then you've got dresses on your arm, and you're sweating, and you're looking for a dressing room. It's a really stressful experience, and sometimes you spend a couple of hours, and then maybe you walk away with one thing that you're happy with, or maybe not. So again, when we talk about the value proposition of our business, we say, come to our store and spend 1 hour, and we promise it will be productive, personalized, and that you will find success. And so how does it work? most people, when they come to our stores, they book an appointment. People are welcome to walk in, but we would treat them sort of like we would if you were walking into a high-end salon or a spa. We'd say, welcome, do you have an appointment today? No, great. Let me tell you a little bit about our business. Our customers fill a survey out about themselves, their size, their preferences, and what they're looking for. And then our styling team takes a look at that, as well as their previous purchase history, and prepares a curated dressing room for them to try. So our customers are not perusing through our store and picking out merchandise themselves, but rather we've pre-selected by looking at their history and understanding what they're coming in for today. So they arrive to that, and then when they leave, they get the product. And we actually, 80% of the time, ship the product to their home or office free of charge, whatever their preference is. And so I know I was told that pictures. So just to kind of walk you through what an experience would be like, this is our Chicago showroom that we just opened in November. We are in River North. When you enter, you're greeted by a smiling stylist at the check-in desk. And again, much like a spa or an appointment, we are ready for you. We introduced a sort of a spa concept. So again, when we talk about value proposition, our customer is busy, she's working a lot. This is meant to be a relaxing experience. So we've actually asked her to remove her shoes, if you see that little bench over there, and take a pair of slippers so that she can be extra comfortable and kind of brought into the experience. A little bit Japanese. Our co-founder and CEO is Japanese, our designer's Japanese, so we do have a bit of Japanese influence in our service. And kind of the look of our store. And so that kind of sets the stage. You request the beverage that you want, and then when you arrive, your beverage is waiting for you up at the bar. So the other interesting thing I wanted to talk about is the bar, which is that it really is the center of our space and is kind of unusual for a store. But the thought was really, you know, when you go to any party, and, you know, it doesn't matter how many rooms you have or how big your home is, everyone's always in the kitchen. And everybody's gathering in the kitchen. And so the idea was to bring community to the center. Come have a drink. Come chat with your peers. Come relax before you start the experience. When we talk about community, which is one of our pillars, we host many events in our showroom. We partner with professional women's organizations and corporations and like-minded brands. And so, again, this space is really about community, and so is the design. Other elements of the design are that we wanted it to really look like an apartment and feel a little bit more comfortable. Chicago is definitely our largest showroom at 5,000 square feet. Many of our other spaces are closer to 2,000, so it's really not that big. But our creative director really didn't like the idea of a typical store and walking in and seeing merchandise. So it's meant to kind of come in, unwind and relax, feel like you're in your own apartment, and then maybe there are items kind of strategically scattered about the space that inspire you and make you want to try them on. We also, for the first time, going with our spa concept, introduced some vanities and other areas in the space so that we can partner with spas and salons to offer different services. So again, think of us as the one-stop shop for the professional woman. She's busy. If she has an hour and she's going to go shopping, she can also get her hair done and her makeup done. Great, because who has time to do all of that separately? So we've been offering, you know, blowouts, makeup touch-ups, manicures, depending on the weekend or for some of our special events. And then this kind of gives you an idea of when we do merchandise, what does it look like? It's very carefully curated, and it's meant to look like sort of a dream closet. And so we wanted her to walk in and imagine and say, oh, I wish my closet looked like that. And hey, maybe I actually don't need that many items to have a complete work wardrobe. So that's kind of our merchandising strategy. I also wanted to point out that we do often partner with local artists. These pieces are actually from Alexander Posen, and we have a rotating collection that we like to work with in each city that we go to. And then I like to say where the magic happens is really in the dressing rooms. So each dressing room is luxurious and unique, and when the customer arrives, she has basically a dream closet that's just for her. Everything is her size. Everything's been thought out. We've looked at her past purchase history. So if she's a returning customer, the stylist has also thought about, could these items go with items that she already owns? If she's tried stuff that she doesn't like, we don't want her to see it because that's a waste of her time. And it's really an hour to get pampered and have an expert work with you, pull you whatever sizes you need, and know, you know, what runs small, what runs big. You don't have to worry about that. You just relax, have your drink. And then finally, I think another thing that we really wanted to focus on was the checkout experience, which I also think can be really stressful. In many stores, you're waiting in lines, you're holding things, it's overwhelming. So the idea here is to take a seat, kind of finish the process, have a drink. Your items will have already been added to your cart, so you're not carrying anything. And it's kind of a final closing out of the experience with your stylist, sharing any feedback you want to share, and then you're finished. So with that, I know we are included in the list of stores to visit in New York. So if you do have time, we have two showrooms, one in Soho and one in Bryant Park. 611 Broadway is our Soho address, and Bryant Park is on 42nd Street, just off of 6th Avenue. So please do swing by, and thank you so much.
Thanks, Rachel. I have been to all of their showrooms and been pampered many times. It's a great it's a great experience. The Chicago showroom is beautiful. It opened November?
Yeah,
just opened in November, and it truly is redefining what is retail. As you can tell, it doesn't look like a typical retail store. It feels very much like an event space. And I know they have plans on running multiple events, because if you go back to what their purpose is, it's also about connecting professional women together in that community piece. It's not just about selling the product. So now I wanted to share some other stores for you guys to see while you're here in New York City. I highly recommend that you take some time, get out of Javits, and experience what it is like to be a consumer today. Because you read about these stores, you read about certain technologies, and it sounds amazing. And sometimes it is, sometimes it's not. And you need to understand what's right for your consumers in that moment and what's going to work for them. So the stores that I picked to share with you today are all newer stores that have some really interesting things going on, and I believe are really taking what their purpose is and expressing it in the store. So Coach just opened up their new flagship. It's called the Coach House. Very beautiful. So there's a, when you first walk in, it feels extremely luxurious. And you have that leather smell. You just like, oh, yes. There's this art installation. That dinosaur is all made of leather, different handbags. And you see different animals made like that throughout the entire space. You'll see elements of customization. I think that's one of the big themes that you're starting to see in almost every store and almost everyone I'm highlighting today. There's an element of personalization or customization, because who doesn't want something that's just unique to them? So you can create your own tags, you can get them monogrammed, and upstairs, because they have three floors, there's a workman area. And one of the guys who's been working with the company for 30 years at headquarters now works in this store. You go up there, you can create your own bespoke, entirely custom bag. You're not able to do that at many luxury retailers. And that's one of the first things you're seeing. And to create your own bag may take more than a day, but you can sit there and customize your own bag after you buy it. You can get it monogrammed, you can add different hardware, and they can you can watch them do it, which is fascinating watching them through the entire process. I talked a little bit about Lululemon earlier, and they're always trying new different retail concepts. So they opened one probably about six-ish months ago up on Fifth Avenue that they created a mind philosophy space. They wanted to go back to their roots, which was not just about selling products. It's about creating that community and being able to live healthfully. And one of the things that they believe is that people need to meditate. And so the bottom part of when you first walk into the store is all your retail products, and the music is bumping. It's like a disco party in there. But then you can go upstairs, and on the mezzanine level on one side is this mind philosophy space. It has these Zen pods set up, so couches, chairs, that then you can put on some Beats headphones, kind of drowned out that bumping music. And you can get walked through 12 different self-guided meditations. So it's trying to teach you how to meditate, and it does a pretty good job of draining out all that different noise. There's also a concierge up there. There's a concierge up there, and they have this also in their Flatiron location in certain stores. So this is a person that you can go talk to and say, what's some healthy restaurants in the area? I'm interested in trying out a new gym routine. What's some gyms that you're partnering with? You know, where should I run today? Do you have running routes? And they also have some digital ways to interact with you and send that information to you. Oh, these are pictures of the Mind Philosophy Zen Pods. And then across the other mezzanine, they have on-site tailoring. So all Lululemons will tailor, I think for free. Don't quote me on that one. And then normally it takes a couple days, though. They send it off-site. This one has an on-site tailor that is able to, you know, if you need them a little bit shortened or if you need a seam fix from something that you've purchased in the past, you can bring it in and they'll do it right there on site. And it's great because you can watch her do it, and it's a beautiful space up there. One of my other favorite stores that's been in San Francisco, it's a startup, it's called Beta, and I'm so excited that they've started to expand, and especially here in New York, so all of you can experience it here during NRF. They are a startup, and they are not just a retailer. They want to be a software company to sell to retailers. So what they did is they are selling more unique, innovative-type products. A lot of their products have been on Kickstarter, through crowdfunding, things like that, products that you may not know what they are, and they do a great job of doing product storytelling. I think that's one thing that every retailer needs to start thinking about is how do you tell your product's story? Why was that product designed? Why was it made? What's its purpose for being there? And especially if you look at these technical products that are coming out, look at home automation. It is so confusing. You never know what's right for you. And so they've created these areas where if you look at those little iPads on the bottom, every single product has a little station that has an iPad next to it. That iPad has content on it that's an overview, a description, a video, and then a way to buy it. So it's giving you that rich information. Their employees are also highly trained on all of their products. But then they, for the software part of it, of what they want to do, is that is rich information that they're now starting to track. They know what pages people are looking at, what products are being looked at, how long are they on certain pages, and all of those iPads have a camera. Those cameras are on. They can read facial expressions. And so this is rich information that they can then provide back to the person who is actually providing those products. Most of the products are on consignment. So how would that be great if you could get this rich information? Are people looking at it? Are they buying it? You know, why did they look at it but not buy it? You know, is there something wrong? Get that detailed information. They also did implement a video analytics solution. They took one of the ones that are off the market and enhanced it. So throughout the space, they do have video analytics to enhance the analytics that they provide back. I have not taken a client there to visit that has not bought. Got some great gifts. One of my favorite new stores in New York, and it's actually the first store in the U.S., is Innisfree. They are a Korean beauty brand owned by Amore Pacific, which is a conglomerate retailer, and it is absolutely beautiful, and you feel like you have that Zen spa moment when you walk into the store. They are 80% of their products are naturally derived. They have an exclusivity to get products from this protected Korean island called Jeju. And when you walk in on that left-hand side, which is this is the picture, is it's one of the largest living walls in the United States right now. So you feel that you're in this natural environment. They have masks, which are the hottest fad right now. If you're looking for gifts to bring home, these masks start at $1.50. Very approachable price point. I think their most expensive mask was only $3.50. But they also do a lot of personalization in this store. Because when you think about beauty, beauty is a hard category to buy as a consumer. They don't know what's right for them. So they do have an area where you can go up and scan and figure out what your skin tone is, because they do a lot with foundations and powders and compacts. And they have multiple of these, and it's self-serve. You don't have to go ask somebody. It's really easy to use. You go up, and it tells you to scan an area on your face, at your jawline, and then on your neck. And then it says, here are the products that are right for you. It gives you a range and then encourages you to try that range to see what's right for you. They also have a lot of areas where you can personalize the products for you. So there's create your own mask. Here's your clay base, but what do you want to add to it? Do you want a little bit of this, a little bit of that, so you can really get what's right for your face? And then they have this beautiful wall that looks like an art installation, and it's their personalized compacts. So throughout the wall, you can pick, you don't just get the standard gray compact, you can pick from multiple different designs and really express who are your true self. So another store that you're looking at purpose is American Eagle. So American Eagle wanted to really think about who's their customer and what do they want. They opened up a store in Union Square that's in the NYU campus. And so they're really targeting these college-age students. And what they, one of the first things that they did is in the back of the store, they put washing machines in. It's a retail store where you do your laundry. They have four different washing machines, four different dryers, and they're going to provide this free of service. Right now, they just opened early last year. They're still waiting to get their final permit, so you can't do it yet, but it will be coming soon. But while you're also doing your laundry for free, you can go upstairs to their community space. They set up a space where college students can come in, connect with others, have a drink, and just relax. They also can walk around the store and buy, which is what they're hoping that they do. They also have a personalization space. I said almost every store you're going to see is going to have personalization. That you can personalize your jeans, buy your jeans, and personalize it for free. You can embroider in initials. You can pick a bunch of different patches right there on site. So they have this space. The other thing that they're looking to do that they have not done yet is move their social media team that's at headquarters to the store. So why not be right in the middle of what your consumers are doing and be able to react in real time and connect with them in a better space? So they built a space in the store to move their social media team. I always have to highlight a Whole Foods Market. Most of you have probably been to one before. This one just opened in Bryant Park, which is also right next door to M.M. LeFleur's Bryant Park showroom. So if you want to hit up two, they're right across from each other. My favorite thing about this store is they created a produce butcher. Seems a little silly, but I know a lot of you that are busy, that are time-starved, want to create a healthy meal for your family. And you go home and you're like, oh, this recipe makes me chop up four different vegetables. That takes time and it's frustrating. So what you can do is you can purchase the item. If it's by weight, you have to purchase it first. And then you take it back to the produce butcher and they'll chop it up however you want it chopped up. What's also great about that is you're going to learn and watch how they do it. So when you go there right now, you can see in these pictures, they have these massive jackfruits. I'm guaranteeing half this room does not know how to cut a jackfruit. I know I didn't. So you can learn something while you're doing that. They also have the biggest area of Whole Foods. This is one of the biggest Whole Foods that has a ready-to-eat area. So they have lots of takeaway areas, ordering, and multiple of their spaces have these ordering kiosks. So you don't have to stand in line. I don't know how many times I've been into a Whole Foods or you've been there where the line's been really long and it frustrates you because you want to order and get in and out. So when you first walk in, there's a news agency area, which is where all their take and go is. But then upstairs where all the hot and the cold bar is, which is what Whole Foods is known for, is where they also have another part of these kiosks where you can order from. So I'd definitely check out the produce butcher and talk to them while you're there. And then last but not least is Everlane. The one thing I want to say about Everlane is unfortunately they closed for the week on Monday. So you're not going to be able to experience it this week. But I'm going to at least talk you through what you could have seen. So for those of you who don't know Everlane, they were an online-only company. And back in 2012, the CEO said, I will kill the brand before I build a physical store. He did not believe in physical stores. And their brand is all about radical transparency. If anyone's ever bought the product, you will know this dress exactly, if it cost me $200, why it cost $200. What factory it came from, how much the fabric costs, all of the information. And so they wanted to bring that information into the physical space. They have been trying up multiple different pop-up stores. So they did a pop-up store in Nordstrom, and they've done some spaces in, I think, San Francisco and New York in the past, but they were pop-up stores. They say this is their first permanent store. And right when you first walk in, it tells you that. And I don't know if you can see that, so I'll read it to you. Welcome to our first store. It took us 2 years of testing, 108 smart people, 42 gallons of white paint, $55,000 of glass, and at least $25,000 in mistakes. And that brings it back to the roots and their purpose. They want to be very vocal about what they're doing and why they're out there. And then throughout the store, there's other ways that they're bringing in that radical transparency. There's areas where you can put some headphones on and listen to t-shirts being made in LA. Is it real? Is it a recording? I don't know. But still kind of fun. And then there's cards set up that talk about where their fabric's coming. Because what they're known for is going out in the world and finding the best producers that they believe are very sustainable. And so you can read about what's being produced in Peru and the other ones. Like most online companies that are opening brick and mortar, it is a showroom only, which means you come in, you try on the product, you buy, and it gets shipped to you. You've seen that Bonobos did that, MM LaFleur does that, Everlane. There's an M Gemini pop-up right now. There's two of them in New York. That's another great one to go see. Italian leather shoes. But all of them, you come in, you get fitted, you get styled, and then they ship to you. But it ships in 2 days. So most consumers are okay with that. And so they do say, we're try-on only, find it, and then shipping's on us. We'll send it to you. So it's a great store. Sorry that you can't see it. They're going to do floor resets about once a month. And they opened like November Thanksgiving time frame. Every time I've been by there, there has been a line to get in the store. And the company's been around for a while, but people just really love the brand and want to see what it's about and have a chance to try on stuff that they've never had, you know, had shipped to them in the past. So those are some of the highlights of stores. There's so many more to see, so grab the map or try out the app and download the app where we have highlighted. You can search by different neighborhoods, technologies you want to see. And I believe Rachel, Ashley, and I can stick around for a little bit if anyone has any questions, if you want to ask about what we presented on. So thank you for your time today. Enjoy NRF.
Thanks, ladies, for great, inspiring photography and our great store tour. Thanks, everyone, for coming. Please take a store tour brochure on your way out if you haven't already gotten one, and take a look at it in the app as well. And please rate our session. We look forward to hearing from you. Our beneficiary for your session ratings is Charity Water this year. Thanks.